Okay, good day. My name is Leighton Peary, and I work with Professor Suleiman, and I'm co-supervised by Professor Mayno. So the title of my talk today is Streamline Technology-Driven Orchestration. So I was thinking that this title is probably going to make a lot of work, because it's going to help in trying to make my talk a lot more logical, just to give you an idea of what exactly it is I'm working towards. So I'm essentially starting technology-driven orchestration. The reason I'm doing this is because I like to better understand the explicit organization of learning activities to influence the effectiveness of educators within formal learning spaces. My scientific goals basically are twofold, and the use of what we're calling an orchestration workbench, right? I want to further try and figure out if we can demonstrate use of such an artifact. So motivation, just briefly, there's a lot going on in the educational technology research area, right? And if you really seriously think about it, there's basically two separate schools of thought, so three actually. So on the one hand, you have people that are convinced that explicitly focusing on the learners is the way to go, right? And on the other hand, you have people that are initiatives or interventions that are focused on education. In between, you have people that are pretty much coming up with hybrid solutions. Work leans more towards educators. Right? Formal learning spaces, as we know them, are actually complex learning environments. And specifically, one of the things that educators tend to struggle with within these formal learning spaces is orchestration, right? So think of what the average lecturer, for example, would otherwise do when you're in a formal learning space. The range of activities that they perform is what we are calling orchestration. So, but there are a couple of issues wrong with orchestration, right? At least as far as we're concerned. In the first case, orchestration is challenging, and there's actually a lot of literature that points to the many aspects of orchestration that make it challenging. But I think top on the list is the idea of time, right? So when a lecturer goes into a classroom to go and run that typical learning session, they are constrained with time. So they have to perform a range of activities within a fixed period of time. And then also realize that orchestration is actually ad hoc, right? Ad hoc in that there is presently, at least as far as we're concerned, there's presently no standard way within which educators tend to orchestrate these learning activities, right? So in most instances, you actually find them using generic tools to perform the different types of learning activities that they would otherwise perform in these sessions. And what we did during the initial scoping and framing phase is we did a couple of things to actually try and ascertain whether or not orchestration is indeed ad hoc. We conducted interviews with eight UCT teaching staff to try and get a better sense of exactly how, what sort of tools and how they orchestrate their learning activities. We also embedded ourselves within these learning sessions explicitly in about three different courses, just so we could get an idea of exactly what goes on in there. And then finally, this is still ongoing, we're analyzing archival records in the form of lecture recording screencasts that are currently archived here at UCT. Right. So take our point here, what we're saying is that yes, we know orchestration is challenging, but we've also proven that orchestration is ad hoc. So with that said, the core claim of my work is straightforward, right? What we're saying is that streamlined orchestration can be attained through the explicit organization of learning activities, right? And we're convinced that this could potentially improve the effectiveness of educators within formal learning spaces, right? I'm being guided by two research questions. In the first instance, I'm interested in trying to figure out exactly how an orchestration workbench will impact the effectiveness of educators, and then also try and ascertain what sort of effect it would have on the overall teaching experience. So we draw inspiration from our proposed approach from the many successes that explicit organization of learning activities has sort of like produced. I think one thing that most of us can relate to, hopefully all of us, is this whole notion of integrated development environments within the software developing community, right? So we know that these tools actually help programmers to be more productive or effective. Of course, there are loads of other examples in other domains. So our approach is really simple. What we are doing basically is explicitly trying to work on the precision management of learning activities. These educators in trying to with a more streamlined way of sequencing the learning activities that would otherwise perform within these formal learnings. And also try and provide them with a centralized way of accessing the range of tools that they might otherwise be interested in order to achieve their overall objectives. So in terms of what we've done, right? So I mean, we are saying or we claim orchestration is ad hoc, and we are proposing this whole new approach, which is broadly centered around organization, right? And so what we did was, towards the end of last year, we performed a comparative analysis between ad hoc orchestration and organized orchestration. And so what we did was we simulated the ad hoc nature of orchestration using portable apps, and then we implemented a workbench user interface, right? The only difference was that portable apps actually, so it's, you probably view portable apps as being something akin to your average operating system like Windows, but then it just makes it possible for you to run it on a USB stick or any portable device. And the reason we did this was we didn't want to expose the users to an interface that they would explicitly know to be different to what we are proposing here. And consistency as well, right? I'll explain that after as I talk about the users that we work with. So the objective was really twofold. We're interested in trying to compare the effectiveness and user experience of the two different orchestration techniques or approaches, right? And so that obviously the our proposed approach would be more effective and it would lead to a more positive user experience, right? We basically measured task speed, the success, comfort, perceived comfort levels of the users and the user experience, right? These all move, so the task speed and the success is mapped to the effectiveness, and the comfort and the user experience is mapped to the experience aspect. I'll talk more about the measurement instrument that we used. I'll actually even explain the what these variables mean when I talk about the measurement. Instrument. So, just to situate this whole thing, here's how we interpreted effectiveness. We're saying an educator is effective if these people that we work with would be effective if they're able to orchestrate the learning activities better, easier, or faster, right? Or if they're able to, the extent towards which they're able to realize their orchestration goals. And then their perceived comfort levels as they're orchestrating these learning activities. And then user experience is just a standard way of interpreting user experience. Right, so we used Attractive 2 as a core measurement instrument. And specifically what we did was we took advantage of the comparison A-B approach, right? This actually makes it possible for you to compare two different products, right? What this survey instrument actually does is it measures the pragmatic quality, the hedonic quality split into two, and the attractiveness quality of a particular product, right? So it's a standard user experience measurement instrument. Or more importantly, what it does is a total of 28 weight pairs of scales, seven of which are each mapped to the four dimensions, so it's 7x4. In terms of the presentation, the analysis, and the interpretation of the results as well, we use the standard attractive tool techniques or recommended techniques. So from the onset, what we did was we actually decided to figure out exactly how many participants would need as a minimum number to try and get statistically significant result. And so we arrived at a total of 53 participants, but unfortunately we only, again, I'll talk more about the implications of having worked with 29 as opposed to the 53 later on. But we ended up recruiting a total of 29 participants, right? These had basically varying levels of studies, teaching experience, and experience using computing devices for teaching. So we worked with, these guys were actually students that are pursuing an education-oriented program, right? And in terms of the teaching experience, what happens with this sample group is every year they go for teaching practice. So it was a perfect sample pool for us to work with. This will help understand the results of the procedure. In terms of the procedure, we actually leverage a within subject study that basically involved two experimental conditions. So it's just the two orchestration techniques, right? Ad hoc and organized orchestration, right? So these are in the form of our embedded variables there. And then the things that we're interested in measuring is of course the task on time, so how long it took for them to orchestrate the learning activities, and the four different attractive two dimensions. And then we're also aware of the fact that the control variables in the form of levels of studies and, you know, teaching experience and computing experience would have implications on the results, and so we took note of this information as well. So what we did was we obviously did the usual drill. We briefed the participants and then had them fill out demographic information in the form of the three different control variables that I spoke about. And then we actually leveraged random experimental blocks and divided these guys into two different groups. So the one group would initially orchestrate the tasks using the Workbench UI and then transition to the portable apps, and then the second group would start with portable, the Workbench UI. We had them orchestrate a scenario from a fifth grade standard textbook. And then it was basically a simple lesson which was centered around fuels, so an introduction to a fifth grade class on what fuels are. So the textbook actually has, the lesson takes the form of directed or guided orchestration because the textbook actually gives you a flow, the teacher guide gives you a flow of exactly what sort of learning activities have to be performed and how and in what sequence. And then after the, the two groups will first of all orchestrate this learning scenario twice, right? So you start with approach one and then transition to approach two for each of the two different groups, right? And then afterwards, what we did was we had them fill out a post-experiment questionnaire, the attractive two questionnaire, and then we debriefed the participants, right? So in terms of the results, right? So the graph here shows, so the vertical axis and the y-axis shows the two different orchestration techniques, and then the x-axis shows you the mean time on task. What was that overall? So the participants, the learning activities faster using the Workbench, right? And it was actually about 15% faster in comparison with using a portable apps approach or ad hoc orchestration. And then in terms of the portfolio presentation, so what the graph shows here is on the vertical axis you have the hedonic quality, which is a combination of HQS and HPI dimensions. The vertical axis shows you the pragmatic quality. And so what the presentation portfolio does basically is it shows you exactly which character region a particular product will fall under. And what you basically need to know here is that so it's a normal XY coordinates here, 0 from 0 is top down. What you just basically need to take note of is that the product that lies in the top right hand corner is what you want. The character region in the top right hand corner is what you want, right? And so what we discovered was that even though both of these approaches actually lie within the neutral region, but the the organized approach lies more towards the desired vision. So in terms of the results for the four different dimensions, what we found was that with the exception of the HQS dimension, the weight-based approach actually had higher scores in the pragmatic quality, the HQI quality, and the attractiveness quality. Right. And further analysis of the dimensions, as in analyzing the individual weight pairs that are tied to the four different dimensions, actually gave us more insight as to why we got these results. So some interesting things in the form of some analysis that we conducted is, importantly, first thing is, so remember we said that we random experimental blocks to try and divide these users into two different groups. So what we discovered was that, so the first group that orchestrated learning activities by transitioning from the weight-based approach to the portable apps approach actually managed to orchestrate the activities 36% faster, right? In comparison to, so if you look at group two, all these were transitioning from portable apps to the weight-based approach. But even though they were faster in transitioning from, even though they were faster in orchestrating the activities from by using portable apps as compared to using the weight-based approach, but the difference is not as pronounced as in group one. And so the initial assumption here was that there was potentially some sort of learning effect, but I think the thing that makes the most sense here is the issue of transitioning from what you perceive to be a complex way of doing things to a simpler way of doing things. So if you look at group one, for instance, and we know that the users perceive the weight-based approach to be simple because we're able to analyze their weight pairs. So if you look at group one, users are transitioning from an approach that is simpler and then going off to a more complex approach. So you notice that complex to simple is bad. Simple to complex is good. So we had similar results for the attractive two dimensions for the individual groups as with the overall results. And then what we did was in the questionnaire, we actually had open-ended questions where users just provided comments with regards to how they perceived the two different approaches to be. These are some of the comments that we got from the users. So, what we found here is that the weight-based approach has the potential to be more effective, right? And more importantly, we actually the results actually indicate that there's a perceived positive user experience when using a weight-based approach as opposed to a portable apps approach. So something else we did was, I mean, we are aware of the fact that there's a wide range of learning models that educators tend to use, right? So what we did towards the end of 2014 was we conducted a case study for a flipped class classroom setup. And the most, it was a second year computer architecture, sorry, about a second year computer architecture course. And the most interesting thing about this course was that there was a fixed range of activities that the lecturer wanted to perform within the formal learning space, right? So this took the form of a quiz, a demonstration where the lecturer would get to showcase a range of hardware artifacts that were being taught in the class. And then there was also like in-classroom discussions that took place. So the study was basically aimed at assessing the feasibility of the proposed approach, right? And we're specifically interested in trying to figure out the extent towards which this proposed approach would aid the overall orchestration technique and the potential impact that the approach would have on the learners, right? And even though the focus here is on educators, but we are aware of the fact that the learner is another important part of that formal learning space, right? And so what we did was we implemented a really simple web-based orchestration web-based platform for the educator to kind of help them in orchestrating the three learning activities. And in terms of what we did to collect or evaluate this this experiment is we actually took note of the way that the educator actually used the the tool that we developed, and also took note of the other tools that were used by the educator to actually orchestrate the activities that wouldn't otherwise be catered for by the platform that we developed. And so we actually analyzed this by taking advantage of lecture recording platform that records lecture sessions here at UCT. And then besides that, we had like informal interview sessions with the educator regularly as the sessions were actually taking place. And then what we did is on the last day of class, one of the objectives was to try and figure out the potential effect it would have on the learning experience. In the last day of class, what we did was we conducted a survey with the students or the learners. So in terms of the tool usage, right, the table shows the different orchestration tools that were used, the frequency within which they were used. This happened within a period of about 1 month in 12 sessions, right? And then the last column is the average duration in which each of the different orchestration tools was. What we found was that so most of the tools were actually content-based tools, so they were meant to basically render content that the lecturer wanted to present to the students. And then most importantly, what we discovered was that the prototype tool that we developed was actually used an average of about 66%. And then also the average switching times, so the transitioning from the web-based UI to the other tools that the educator would have used in a typical session was measured, and on average, you notice that it was actually done, the switching was done 2 times. In terms of the learner survey, overall, the results seem to suggest that the students perceive the tool to have had some sort of impact in helping them understand the logical organization of the different learning activities, right? And the static sequencing that was used in developing the tool was found to be helpful. And then a specific timer feature was also perceived to be useful by the learners. So what we did here is we proved the feasibility of the approach. And what we noticed was that there's a neutral flow of activities. Remember I mentioned the average of 2 times switching from one orchestration tool to the next. And then the results also suggest that there's a potential, the tool has a potential to facilitate positive learning experience to the learners. In terms of what I'm currently working towards, so there's a total of about 3 experiments that I'm yet to conduct. In the first instance, we're interested in so remember I talked about this whole notion of different learning models. We're interested in investigating this approach in another authentic learning environment, but this time around we're trying to try and figure out exactly what sort of effect it would have on peer learning, right? So what happens at UCT is whenever there are tutorial sessions for undergraduate students, you have undergraduate students that are in higher levels that sort of like help with the tutorial. So the plan is to make sure that we have a tool that, because it's usually open-ended, they're just given instructions as to what is exactly expected of them, but the plan is to come up with a more guided approach using our proposed approach. And then we're aware of the fact that there are certain important things that we haven't measured, specifically the orchestration load that is imposed on the educator. And so we are interested in doing this by also concentrating more on the pre-session management side of things, right? So remember I mentioned that pretty much all the tools that we've come up with take advantage of static enactment of activities. So what we're trying to do is try and make it more dynamic and generalized. And then also finalize the analysis of the lecture recordings so that we have a much more comprehensive view of the ad hoc nature of orchestration, right? And then what's also important here is that, I mean, so what if we do this, right? We are aware of of this notion of open education resources, and so what we see this in doing or in helping doing is to kind of like make it possible for these sort of orchestration appliances to be shareable amongst educators, right? Taking into mind the idea that most of the things that are usually done with regards to orchestration are somewhat generic. And so the idea is to try and identify the generic things and be able to have these educators reuse and share the orchestration appliances. Okay, so these are some of the references I use, and I'll take questions if there are any. So the thing is, I intend to use them. I intend to use them because it will help me provide a lot of valid arguments for why we think orchestration is ad hoc. And what I did in the process is I was recording all the interviews, so we have data with regards to what exactly was discussed, what sort of things came out of them.
So you recorded them and transcribed them?
I have not yet transcribed them, but I recorded. But the idea is to transcribe them, obviously. Yeah.
I don't know, how did you actually choose the attractive?
Attractive?
Yeah.
So, there are a couple of things here. Number one, remember this is a controlled experiment. Attractive 2 is actually perfect for control or lab experiments, right? Number two is one of those very few measurement instruments that actually allow you to compare two different products. And then number three, and this is important, right? The fact that it enabled us to actually measure certain strands of effectiveness. Remember, I mentioned the PQ dimension and the user experience all at once. Otherwise, we probably have had to use two different survey instruments, measurement instruments.
Okay, so the metrics that you use, that you evaluate,
those that I came up with.